Afternoon session. This is going to be our last panel with our distinguished invited panelists from abroad. And after that, we're going to have a small break, and then we're going to wrap up the discussion in German. Thank you very much. I'm going to hand over to our panel chair, Kübra, who is a very distinguished journalist, publicitor, and blogger. And she has also been in this field of research on Islamophobia for a long time. And she has been studying at the SOAS in London, so she's very familiar with the intersectional arguments of our conference today. And I'm very happy to have her here to chair this panel today. The floor is yours.
The topic of our panel today is counter strategies and empowerment, and the panel aims to discuss what the current strategies are and then elaborate on future strategies, bringing into arts and culture but also research. And we have four wonderful panelists. I'll start with Deepa. Deepa Kumar is a professor of media studies at Rutgers University in the United States. Her most recent publication is her book Islamophobia and the Politics of Empire. She has authored more than 80 books, journal articles, book chapters and articles in independent and mainstream media. And she has shared her expertise in numerous media outlets such as the BBC, the New York Times, NPR, etc. and in international and national news media outlets. Thank you so much for being here. I'll proceed with James. James Carr lectures in the Department of Sociology in the University of Limerick. Building on previous scholarly and policy-oriented publications in 2016, James published his book Experiences of Islamophobia, Living with Racism in the Neoliberal Era, which focused on anti-Muslim racism in Ireland, set to the international context. James has published research with the Immigrant Council of Ireland, supported by the Open Society Foundations, entitled Islamophobia and Dublin Experiences and How to Respond, the recommendations of which he continued to work on with national and international partners. James is the author of the European Islamophobia Report, Submissions on Ireland for 2015 and 16 and 17, and he's the contributor of the Yearbook of Muslims in Europe for Ireland for the same period. Thank you. And last but not least, Salman Sayyid is based at the University of Leeds, where he holds a chair in decolonial thought and is the head of the School of Sociology and Social Policy. Additionally, he is the co-editor of the Iqbal Center of the Study of Contemporary Islam and the founding editor of international peer-reviewed academic journal Reorient, the Journal of Critical Muslim Studies. Previously, Sayyid was professor and the inaugural director of the International Center for Muslim and Non-Muslim Understanding in Australia. He has also held academic positions in London and Manchester. Professor Sayyid is a political theorist whose work engages with critical theory and the politics, histories, and cultures of the Global South. Some of his major publications include A Fundamental Fear, A Postcolonial People, Thinking Through Islamophobia, and Recalling the Caliphate. He's a frequent contributor to national and international media. Thank you. We will start with James. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Kübra. Thank you for the introduction, and thanks to the organizers for inviting me to speak here today. As I've been introduced, I'm a sociologist. I'm based in the University of Limerick in Ireland. What I want to spend some time on today is, I want to be a little bit provocative, but I want to start to get us to think about how we can challenge anti-Muslim racism, whether in the Irish context or indeed abroad, but I'm going to base my discussion on the Irish context. I'm going to start by providing you with some insights on the Irish context in terms of the experiences of anti-Muslim racism, a little bit about their effects as well. Then I'll move on to some recommendations from research that I undertook there that Kübra referred to, which was based in Dublin. The studies that you can see on the screen there essentially sum up a lot of the empirical research I've been doing for the last number of years. Ireland is not unlike other states in the European and indeed the broader global context when it comes to anti-Muslim racism. the experiences, the tropes that are used in experiences of anti-Muslim hostility and discrimination, they resonate across that to a word, to the actual words that are used against people in interactions that people experience. In terms of the experiences, the study you can see here, the experiences of Islamophobia study, that was the first study undertaken in the Irish context, and it provided data on statistical insights and also qualitative insights on anti-Muslim racism in Ireland. In terms of hostility, in that study, one in three people stated that they had experienced specifically anti-Muslim hostility. In terms of discrimination, same study, one in three people experienced specifically anti-Muslim discrimination. When we control for sex, when it comes to hostility, Muslim women 1.6 times more likely to experience it than Muslim men. In discrimination, almost twice as likely for Muslim women to experience it when compared to Muslim men. The Dublin study is particularly interesting. So while both of these studies, and indeed the work I've been doing for the European Islamophobia Report for the last number of years, and other researchers I've engaged in, have provided qualitative insights and quantitative insights on their experiences, the Dublin study spoke to, or asked Muslim people at least, what they feel would be the best way of responding to anti-Muslim racism. These researchers also pointed up the effect that anti-Muslim racism can have, and we've referred to this a few times during conversations, but I think it's good to get an idea from the words of Muslim people themselves who took part in the studies. So on screen you can see a few short quotes, and essentially what I'm getting at here is that in the current context, due to the lack of state intervention, people are engaging in what I call management strategies, also referred to as coping strategies when it comes to experiences of anti-Muslim racism. So we can see people managing their emotions, fear, for example, and so on, managing their body. Does one look Muslim when one goes out? Does one wear the hijab? Managing space. Does one take extra security measures when one's out and about? And this notion of managing the image of Islam or managing the image of the Ummah, maybe might be a better way of putting it, in a context where tropes about Muslimness present Muslims in such a negative light that people are oftentimes asked to apologize, if you will, for what's gone on. So a number of years have passed between these studies and how they've when they were undertaken in terms of context. What's the state been doing about it? And it's fundamental for the argument I'm making today. Kulveer is a Sikh man. Kulveer has experienced anti-Muslim racism on a range of different occasions. On one such occasion, with a friend of his, they were set upon by two individuals, and his friend was stabbed in the hand, defending himself while he was being called Osama bin Laden, in a town in the centre of Ireland, not a big town by any means. Kulveer is clear. For him, the state's approaches to challenging racism at the moment are paper policies. Nice, catchy words, but it's just talk, talk, talk. Azim, a representative of one Muslim community organization, refers to it as being superficial. Ahmed, another representative, talks of a lot of talk but no action. So there's something going on here. There's a consistency, if you will, and a lack of activity by the state. Fanning et al. And other colleagues in the Irish context, including myself, have referred to these as paper policies. That the state is engaged in sort of a window dressing when it comes to challenging racism, and in particular, anti-Muslim racism. And why is this the case? Well, I don't think I need to elaborate too much on notions of the state being a racial state, and we know from the work of Goldberg and others as well, in that context, of the manner in which a state can construct ideas of belonging. And in the context of challenging racism, in the Irish context, the state presents itself as a sort of a neutral arbiter, a sort of, it's this happy kind of middle guy in the middle who's engaging with communities, but really it's not doing anything substantive when it comes to challenging racism. More importantly for me here is this notion of the neoliberal state when we're challenging racism. The neoliberal state privatizes racism. I think Junaid referred to this morning in terms of the trouble we have with the word Islamophobia. In a neoliberal context, racism is privatized as well to being an individual pathology. It's the one or two bad apples as opposed to the structural factors that inform racist practices on the ground and the exclusionary practices as Miles and Brown would refer to. In terms of managing your racism, though, and managing anti-racism, the neoliberal state also outsources that responsibility. In the Irish context, and I would argue in others, care for racism, if I can use that term, is outsourced to civil society organizations, for example. But at a very basic level, it's outsourced to the self, to the person who's experiencing the racism. It's your responsibility, if you're a Muslim woman and you experience hostility because you're Muslim on the street, look less than Muslim, it goes. Take off the hijab, then you won't experience this. If you're a Muslim guy and you look like a Muslim guy, whatever that is, look less Muslim. If you're a Sikh guy who happens to get in the crossfires of this racism, look less. So, you're left as a manager of your body, the space, your emotions, and the image of Islam. You're an ambassador for Islam. So, we do nothing. No, we don't. We try and do something, okay? So, the argument that I want to communicate today is based on the voices of Muslim communities. And the recommendations you can see on screen here, there are 10 recommendations. They directly come from Muslim communities in the Dublin city area. I took part or interviewed and focus grouped with 66 Muslim men and women in Dublin from a range of ethno-national backgrounds, including, of course, Irish, from a range of traditions of Islam, and from people as young as 18 years of age up to 80 years of age. So it's quite inclusive, and purposively so. 66 people, and even split between men and women. I want to speak to just a few of the themes from these today. That is raising awareness, the space of media, education and diversity, and hate crime legislation. So raising awareness. There was consensus among the participants of the Dublin study that given the ubiquity of anti-Muslim tropes, that there needed to be created a counter-narrative that would challenge the racialized imagery of Muslim communities. It was felt that such a counter-narrative would go some way toward challenging the all-too-pervasive negative stereotypes of Muslim communities, and importantly, their effects. For Salah, for example, first and foremost, you have to make the larger community kind of understand that Muslim people are not different. They are them. They are part of this country. They are part of the community. They are Irish citizens. A central aspect of public awareness campaigns that aim to challenge anti-Muslim racism from the perspective of participants then is a focus on creating a recognition of Muslim men and women as being a part, a vibrant part of Irish society. Within this, participants are keen to focus on this notion of normalcy, the normalcy of Muslims. In other words, campaigns that aim to raise awareness need not refer to Islam per se, but focus on Muslims as people, the otherwise mundane. For example, the shared realities of being a parent, being a football fan, having to do the school run, being a student. All these activities and identities that we all share across a whole range of societies, all societies. Awareness-raising campaigns with this focus would counter those racializing discourses that dehumanize Muslim communities, emphasizing diversity as opposed to singularity, common humanity instead of difference. Zara and Mariam's comments speak directly to this focus on normalcy. Zara, just normalize Muslims. We're not aliens or monsters. So you're like a Muslim, you're like us. Like that was said to me after a big conversation I have with colleagues. So you were like us, and I said yes. Mariam, I wouldn't like to be promoted as someone who, oh my God, she is Muslim. I don't want that, I'm human. I work, I eat, I drink, I drive, I'm human. Just a simply a different faith, that's all. Interestingly, when asked on their views, only one participant stated that he would be supportive of campaigns that explicitly target anti-Muslim racism in their content. Another spoke of the need to have campaigns that clearly speak to anti-Muslim racism specifically, as well as those that function to humanize Muslim communities through the mundane. Racism needs to be called out for what it is. To fail to do so is to perpetuate the blindness that we see around us when it comes to challenging racism in the contemporary context. Racism is presented to us, or is not presented to us, as a problem in society through this blindness, and we need to challenge this. In this context, awareness-raising campaigns such as this, when they're being constructed, care must be taken that we don't repeat the racist trope in our content itself. Anti-racism campaigns may be, in effect, counterproductive if they do, if they essentially do the job of the racist assailant for them. According to Maria, if you're making a campaign, retelling racism as I call it, people will feel, if they have not experienced anything themselves, they will feel insecure, to be honest. Moreover, as one Muslim woman put it, reflecting on a central trope in the gender constructions, racialized constructions of Muslimness, in reference to campaigns, she stated, "I don't want to be promoted as someone who is vulnerable. Because when you show people that we're vulnerable, then they'll treat us in that way. It could be good, it could be bad. I don't want to be treated like someone special because I'm not." In terms of raising awareness and drawing further on the voices of the participants in the research, in addition to engaging with non-Muslim communities, there was also a need to raise awareness amongst Muslim communities, amongst Muslim men, women, and children, indeed, of their rights and how they can access their rights. And there was a call for supports from civil society organizations to help in that regard as well. Participants in Study 2 held, probably unsurprisingly, predominantly negative perspectives towards media in general, so much so to the extent that some believed that there was an actual anti-Muslim agenda at work. Participants argued for greater inclusion, media inclusion, when it comes to Muslims in the media, in the Irish context, and also an engagement with media outlets vis-a-vis the sensationalist reporting practices we see. With the exception of some usual community Muslim community representatives, there are very few Muslim voices in Irish mainstream media. Indeed, only two spring to mind at the time of writing, unless the issue relates directly to so-called Muslim issues. The inclusion of Muslim voices in mainstream media on a range of topics would go some way towards this rehumanizing project, if we can call it that for a moment, and that's not unproblematic when it comes to Muslim communities in Ireland. Rabia, you never see Muslims on TV if it's not about Islam or a documentary on Islam. If you were to get a Muslim or even just a group of people to do some sort of program, it doesn't have to be on religion, just to show that they're normal people. Another note on engagement with media outlets referred to reporting standards. And participants felt that media outlets used language that stigmatized Muslim communities. It was suggested that efforts should be made to engage with media outlets and media producers so that they would be sensitized in terms of the impact of such reporting practices on Muslim communities. Saad, for example, one Muslim gentleman who took part in the research, when there is a problem, say for "we don't wish it happens, but if there's an attack in Rome or in London or in Iraq, the media concentrate on Islam and Muslims doing that, and every Muslim person ends up in suspicion. So the media shouldn't represent us like that, and someone needs to talk to the media about that." In the media context, then, there were two calls, one for inclusion, greater inclusion for Muslims, not because of Islam and Islamic issues, but as members of Irish society, and the second one was to challenge the negative reporting practices. Muslim parents, and this has come up by a number of speakers already, but in the Irish context, Muslim parents and children face discrimination in and accessing education. The issue of discrimination accessing education is actually something which is up in the air right now. The state is taking some action towards addressing it. We'll watch this space. In the classroom, students have experienced anti-Muslim racism with aspects of their faith identity being directly targeted. Amir, a young Muslim guy who took part in my research, when he was in school, was told to shut up Allah by his teacher. Another young Muslim woman in the classroom is told to take that stupid thing off her head because she simply asked the teacher to reframe a question. More, arguably, as important is the fact that when students do experience this, they're not being provided with the supports they need. So when they seek support from teachers and so forth, it falls on deaf ears. Participants suggested that civil society organizations work with education providers to develop and implement in and pre-service teacher training modules which would directly address anti-Muslim racism. And I'm not talking about biryani and bhajis, I'm talking about something that will engage with racism for what it is and emphasizing the structural and the individual impacts of racism. In relation to the young students themselves, participants suggested that the design and implementation of modules that would be delivered to school-going children, arguably in the high school area, that would engage in ideas around Muslims and stereotypes around Muslims, experiences of anti-Muslim racism, how to challenge stereotypes, and how you can seek advice and support if you witness it, and also if you experience it. Interestingly, it was also suggested this need not necessarily be done in the context of religious education, which I would argue it shouldn't be done in that space, but instead where the focus is on diversity and this, indeed the sameness of Muslim communities and non-Muslims. Musa, they've put something small. They have to put something small, small subject to the kids in the schools, showing the good things, not just what they hear in the news, because the kids, when you're told something, it stays in your head. You never forget it. The last recommendation I want to touch on for a second before I go back to addressing the context very briefly is in the area of hate crime legislation and the need for hate crime legislation in Ireland. As it stands, Ireland is without any legal remedy for hate crime. If somebody engages in hate crime or experiences hate crime hostility, for example, on the basis of their Muslimness or other identities, the perpetrator will receive a penalty which will be in line with the standard criminal offence. There isn't any recognition of the, thank you, there isn't any recognition of the hate element in it, the animus that's involved. Paul Agansky in 2008 recognises the manner in which, on one hand, hate crime is a message crime, and Barbara Perry speaks to this as well. It sends a message that you're not part of society, you shouldn't be in our society. You don't belong here, you are the other. Agansky argues that hate crime legislation can do the converse. It can have, serve a declaratory purpose to say that, actually, this is not accepted in society. We will not accept anti-Muslim hostility or hostility against other groups so targeted. Hate crime legislation is a fundamental element of what Giroux refers to as a public pedagogy, and Jasmine referred to it earlier on, and I'll talk more about it in a second. I contend that each one of these recommendations, all 10, and indeed focusing on the ones I've just spoken about, can play an important role in what Henri Giroux refers to as a public pedagogy. A public pedagogy that challenges anti-Muslim racism, even in the neoliberal context we're in. So it is clear from those who took part in the study, study two, and indeed the other studies I've engaged with Muslim communities in Ireland, that for those who took part, for them in particular, the state plays a fundamental part if we're going to challenge anti-Muslim racism. It's an important potential avenue through which challenges can be laid down to anti-Muslim hostility and discrimination. I agree that the Irish state, and not only the Irish state, other states as well, can be a key actor if we are to meaningfully challenge anti-Muslim racism. Now, this may seem strange given what I've argued a few moments ago about the neoliberal state and the neoliberal, the racial state as well. However, I have previously argued in favour of engaging with the state in a sort of almost Faustian pact in terms of neoliberal terms. Here, though, I want to make the argument that the state is the key, arguably the only actor that can support a sustained challenge to anti-Muslim racism, and indeed all racisms that go with it and other forms of exclusion. I concur with Giroux, who argues that, quote, any attempt to address the politics of the new racism must begin by reclaiming the language of the social and affirming the project of an inclusive democracy. End quote. We must place the state front and centre in our efforts to challenge anti-Muslim racism, to move beyond accepting the state as a bogeyman, not uncritically, obviously. Quote, to imagine the state as a vehicle for democratic values and a proponent for social and racial justice, from Giroux again. I am, of course, mindful of context. Ireland is not as overtly, in terms of the state and their explicit practices at least, is not as overtly or aggressively racist as other states may be, but this is not a competition. Giroux argues the need for a widely dispersed public pedagogy. I think Professor Sayyid and his work recently refers to counter-narratives and arguably doing the same role, if we are to challenge racism. And it is argued here that this is a fundamental part to play if we're going to challenge or create such a pedagogy. This pedagogy will need to engage with neoliberal states on neoliberal terms, otherwise I fear that the experiences of anti-Muslim hostility and discrimination that I outlined earlier and their effects will go on unabated. Arguably, the voices of those who took part in this research could be perceived as, again, an outsourcing of responsibility to racism that one has to manage their experiences yet again, people forced to come up with their own solutions. Maybe so. But I think it's been clear throughout the research as discussed yesterday and today, the days of simply documenting anti-Muslim racism are behind us. It is time to start not living with anti-Muslim racism. Civil society organisations, Muslim representative organisations have a key role to play, but the state also has to step up to the mark if we're going to challenge this. Thank you.
Okay, so I'm going to begin. Can you hear me? Yeah. I'm going to begin actually with two anecdotes, both from Germany, and then I'm going to, you know, begin my formal presentation. So I came a few days early, and I had the privilege of doing a walking tour of the Third Reich, Hitler's Germany, as it's called. It was a fantastic tour. For those of you who are visitors, I strongly encourage you to do this walking tour. At any rate, we visited the Memorial to Murdered Jews of Europe, which was quite powerful. Those of you who are from Berlin, of course, know what this looks like. But it starts off with a few small blocks, and then it builds into these huge, towering blocks in which you feel so powerless to actually do anything. You get lost in these blocks, and then you come out on the other side, and there's small blocks again. And our tour guide actually made a very powerful point. She said, it was not just Hitler and the Nazis who were responsible for the murder of 6 million Jews in Europe, but millions of others who actually participated in it, whether it was the people who worked in concentration camps, whether it was informants, whether it was those who turned them in, or whether it was, you know, governments that refused to take Jews fleeing the Holocaust. And here we're talking about the US, Canada, and so forth. So this is a huger problem than just the Nazis and their collaborators and so on. And of course, the question is, why does this happen? And the context here is, of course, a deep crisis of German society, a social crisis, as well as an economic crisis. The defeat in World War I, the reparations, and then the inflation of 1924, which wipes out people's savings, which then gets even worse in 1929 after the stock market crashed, which then leads millions of people who've been trained through the military, the SA, 2.5 million armed and trained soldiers on the rampage, wanting a scapegoat for their anger, right? And so these are the conditions that give rise to the anti-Semitism that we see. At the same time, however, you also see a rising working class movement. You see the KPD, the Communist Party, also rising and offering different kinds of solutions. And in the election, just before Hitler's actual coming to power, the KPD and the National Socialists get about the same amount of votes. But Hindenburg hands over the chancellorship to Hitler because for the industrialists that he represented, this was a drastic solution to a drastic problem. The way that Rosa Luxemburg put it in another period is was socialism or barbarism, and the industrialists chose barbarism. And the people on whose backs the rehabilitation of German capitalism occurred was, of course, the Jews, but also the left, right? It was also the left that was targeted and so on. And this is where I think, you know, Junaid talked about racial capitalism. It's really the racialization of one group of people becomes the means in the 1930s to restore, rehabilitate, and reproduce German capitalism. And I think that's a useful concept by which to think of not just the how, but also the why that people get racialized at particular moments. Now, the tour guide didn't go through all this history, this is me, but I do want to go back to her. She was an incredibly intelligent woman, and she talked about the Nuremberg laws, and I think that's important, right? Because anti-Semitism of the 1930s and 40s and so on was not just a set of bad ideas in people's heads, it was actually institutionalized within the law. The disenfranchisement of the Jewish people was both a set of practices and systemic as well as a set of ideas. And she argued how every little step was a step in the direction of the final solution. And what was remarkable, she identified as Jewish herself, is she said, look at this memorial and look at the small steps. That's where we are when it comes to Muslims. So you need to start now when you see somebody pulling off the hijab of a woman on a bus. You need to stop that now before we can see concentration camps go up again and the rounding up of Muslims all across Europe. And I thought that was a really powerful statement of solidarity. And I think, you know, it's really commendable that the Jewish Museum is hosting such a conference, because I think if any group of people knows and has a historical memory of what it means to be racialized and persecuted, it is German Jews. At any rate, so that's my first anecdote. The second is the story of Magnus Hirschfeld. People may know who he is. He was a German physician and an advocate of gay rights. And I bring him up because his book, Racismus, if I'm pronouncing it right, which was translated into English in 1938, was the first book of its kind to use the word racism in the title. Now, for many within Europe, it was very comforting to think that the roots of racism can be located just within the Nazi experience, right? So this is an extraordinary thing that has happened. The German ideology of Nazis, the Nazi ideology of racism is an aberration, it's a retrogression from modernity and so on. But Hirschfeld argued that the Enlightenment division of people into different races actually creates the conditions for racism and white supremacy. So far from being an aberration, it's very much a part of the colonial imperial experience. In other words, Theo Goldberg was not the first to advance this argument. It goes back all the way to Magnus Hirschfeld. And in fact, as many scholars since then have argued, Nazism actually drew quite heavily from the eugenics movement, which was quite strong in the United States and the UK. And of course, the UK was, you know, the most powerful colonial power at that time. The US, a settler colonial society built on slavery and the expropriation of land from the indigenous people. So why these two anecdotes? Basically, to make the argument that I want to make about ending Islamophobia, which is that projects of racialization are ultimately about projects of empire and the establishment and consolidation of capitalism, both of which rely on racism. Now, Islamophobia, I want to argue, is not simply a prejudice or a set of bad ideas, but it is rooted in the society that we live in. And in the rest of my time, I'm going to focus on the United States to talk about the structural context for Islamophobia. And of course, Islamophobia in Europe and in the United States, there are similarities, but there are also differences. But I think there's a way in which the US-led project of imperialism on the global stage, based on racial capitalism, provides a framework, if you will, for the rest of the world. So I think it's useful to study the US example for that reason. Now, I'll say a couple of things about hate crimes. Many speakers have already talked about it. In the US, one of the dominant ways that Islamophobia is understood is as hate crimes. And hate crimes include verbal and physical attacks, as well as the desecration of mosques and Muslim community centers. Groups like Carr and SPLC and so on count these hate crimes. And it is Muslim women, as many speakers have pointed out, who bear the brunt of these attacks. Now, the FBI defines a hate crime as, quote, a traditional offense like murder, arson, or vandalism with an added element of bias. For purposes of collecting statistics, Congress has defined a hate crime as a criminal offense against a person or property motivated in whole or in part by the offender's bias against a race, religion, disability, sexual orientation, ethnicity, gender, or gendered identity, end quote. Now, I think it's important to collect such information and to hold the perpetrators of such hate crimes accountable to the extent that this is possible under the judicial system we have, where the laws are by no means neutral. But Islamophobia is about more than hate crimes committed by individuals who hold a quote-unquote bias, because such a definition fails to explain why these individuals hold such a bias. Why have incidents of hate crimes spiked in the US so many years after 9/11, and to what do we owe this bias? James talked about neoliberal racism and the way in which racism is individualized, and indeed, that's exactly right. That is to say, even while racism is experienced and carried out on the individual level, to limit our understanding of Islamophobia to hate crimes or to microaggressions, which are very difficult and very painful. You know, somebody asked a question about microaggressions in the last session, and there's a lot of research on how it not only has psychological effects in the form of depression, anxiety, and so on, but the mental and the physical are located, right? There is a mind-body connection, and people develop ailments, heart disease, diabetes, and so on, having to live in a racist society. So it's important to understand these, the ways in which racism is played out in these societies, but at the same time, we have to understand the institutional structures which actually give rise to these forms of racism. And I think that's where empire becomes important. And in my book, Islamophobia and the Politics of Empire, I set out to explore how the image of the Muslim enemy is tied to a set of practices that sustain and reproduce empire. And building on Edward Said's as well as other people's work, I argue that Islamophobia is an ideology that has come to be accepted as normal, as common sense in the war on terror era, and that it makes certain assumptions about an essentialized Muslim identity natural. Things like Muslims are prone to violent, they are essentially misogynistic, they're driven to rage, they lack rationality, and so on. These sorts of ideas appear common sense, they appear natural, they appear like they don't need rigorous questioning. But these ideas, of course, don't exist in a vacuum. They are part of a larger structure. And this structure, really, most immediately, I argue in my current work, is drawn from the reconfiguration of US society after World War II. That is, the US, as one of two giant hegemons on the world stage after World War II, creates a national security state after 1947, which allows it both to maintain control domestically and to actually control and assert its hegemony on the global stage. So the top secret National Security Council paper, NSC 68, laid out a vision for US post-war grand strategy. It was written in 1950 and declassified in 1975. It was one of the most influential foreign policy documents of the Cold War. What did it call for? Well, it called for massive increases in military spending, a civil defense program to ensure loyalty among the citizenry, a media propaganda campaign to build and sustain public support, and a psychological warfare and propaganda campaign abroad. And the way it put it is that every aspect of life, social life, political life, intellectual life, economic life, had to be reconfigured in order to serve imperial aims, right? In order to strengthen the aims of the US abroad as well as the national security state domestically. And the US, of course, also at this point abandoned any effort to distinguish between national security and global security. And confronted by the collapse of the European and Japanese empires and the rise of the Soviet Union, it fell to the US, according to this document, to beat back the threat to civilization. However, the growth of the military-industrial complex, as it was called, did not recede after 1991, after the collapse of the Soviet Union. Instead, it gained a new lease on life as a new threat to quote-unquote Western civilization, once posed by communists, was now replaced by jihadists, by Islamic fundamentalists. And so in this sense, the US national security state and the securitization of the US is not new. It did not begin after 9/11. Rather, it draws from most immediately the Cold War national security state. And in fact, the current book I'm working on is about the national security state and gender, race, and class, and how that gets mobilized from the Cold War to the War on Terror. It is this imperial system, born in the post-World War period and strengthened in the War on Terror era, which is the crucible of Islamophobia. And in the last book, I argue that if we look at the infrastructure of empire, and if we look at how various institutions actually support Islamophobia, then it becomes important for us to see what these institutions are, such as the federal, state, and local government, the legal apparatus, the electoral arena, the academy, think tanks, the corporate media, and the national security apparatus, which is the FBI, local police departments, CIA, and so on, all of which work with their own logic, but also work to strengthen empire through the logic of Islamophobia. So let me talk about a couple of these. Obviously, I don't have time to go through every single one of these within the matrix of Islamophobia. Let me just talk about three: the electoral arena, the corporate media, and the security apparatus. Actually, maybe I'll just skip the electoral arena, since Mustafa already gave you the statistics on how every 4 years, when there is a presidential election, Islamophobia spikes because political candidates find it useful to scapegoat Muslims in order to garner votes. And so it's very useful for political candidates, not just the Republicans, but the Democrats as well. This is very much a bipartisan project to demonize Muslims in order to appear to be tough on terror and in order to gain votes. So that's all I'll say about that. The media also have a vested interest in covering not every quote-unquote terrorist attack around the world, but attacks on the West, right? This becomes covered in a 24/7 loop because such coverage is good for business, it is good for ratings, and it actually pads the bottom line. And of course, who gets called during these crises to share their expertise? It's basically people from think tanks, academics who get money from the Islamophobic network, and so forth, all of who reinforce each other, former government officials, current government officials, CIA officials, all of whom reproduce a certain story about how scary, terrorism actually is. And I have a little quibble with Janan. The number that I have for the number of Americans who've been killed in the US since 9/11 is 104 from the New America Foundation, not 140, but maybe we'd look at different sources. I can't see where she is. Anyway, so since 9/11, 104 Americans have been killed by jihadists and people who've been inspired by jihadi violence and so on. And so you have to keep the moral panic alive by constantly covering this supposed threat. Actually, more people die from drowning in their bathtubs than they do from a terrorist-related incident, but there is no war on bathtubs, as you might conclude. Last example was the national security state. So there are many, many, many cases of entrapment. This is where FBI agents or their informants actually go into Muslim communities and act as agents provocateurs, coercing them to carry out attacks and so on. And when they do, all of a sudden, the police are right there to accost them, and yay, yet another person, yet another terror attack has been foiled. Why? Well, doing this actually makes sure that the multi-billion dollar terrorism industry stays alive and continues to get funded. So in other words, there are different rationales in each of these spheres, but together they help to reproduce Islamophobia on a national scale. Now, the last thing I'll say, because I'm running out of time, is that the homeland security industry doesn't simply target Muslims, but it has also gone after the left. And laws and policies originally designed to be used against Muslims, Arabs, and South Asians have been expanded to be used against Occupy Wall Street activists, against Black Lives Matter activists, against environmental justice activists, and so on. So what starts off as a targeting of Muslims gets expanded to the rest of the left. And again, this is what we mean by racial capitalism, right? Which is that all threats to the system, and certainly activists in the Occupy movement, the Black Lives Matter movement, the environmental justice, are threats to the reproduction of neoliberal capitalism. All of these get configured together in order to reproduce the system. And racialization processes are very central to all of this. And the same was true, right, of Nazi Germany's, but not just the Jews, it was the left as well that was targeted. So I'll come to a close with this, which is, what are the solutions? So I think countering Islamophobia, first of all, is not, in my opinion, the responsibility of Muslims, although Muslims who do take part in that display a lot of courage. I think it's the responsibility of all of us, of all citizens, of all people of conscience, to actually stand up and fight against this form of racism. And I think that this is not just a moral question. It is a moral question, right? We must remember what Pastor Niemöller said. First they came for the Jews, then they came for the communists, and finally when they came for me, nobody was left to fight for me. So it is a moral question, but I think it's also a question of solidarity based on material interests. Which is to say that the war on terror costs trillions of dollars, money that is not spent on things that Americans actually die from. Millions die from a lack of access to healthcare, right? Every year, close to 50,000 commit suicide. These are mainly, by the way, white men who are middle-aged because they don't have access to good jobs, they've lost their families, and so forth. We have a huge drug opioid crisis in the United States. So in other words, there is a social, economic, and political crisis in the US, and instead of building a free healthcare system, instead of funding good jobs programs and so forth, Islamophobia and the terrorist threat serves to divert trillions, I'm not talking about billions, just try to wrap your head around this number, trillions are diverted to strengthening the national security state and prosecuting the war on terror. So I'll end with this, which is that the vast majority of people in the United States and around the world actually have no interest in Islamophobia. And while we should fight against hate crimes, and we should stop that person on the bus who's harassing the Muslim woman with a hijab, as that tour guide put it, and while we should stop job discrimination, I think we've also got to set our eyes on the prize, which is empire and racial capitalism, and we have to work towards dismantling that system. Thank you.
It's working? Okay. Thank you very much. It's quite normal to thank the organizers of these things, but I think this is not just a customary thanks. I think it's really, really important that the Jewish Museum and Humboldt University have got together to organize a space for this type of conversation. It's very easy to have peaceful agreement. What is much more challenging and much more necessary is to have the space for peaceful disagreement. And on that note, I was ready to disagree with all my panelists, and all the panelists really, but I find that it's really difficult because one of the disadvantages of speaking last is that everyone has said what needed to be said, and you just don't know what you're going to say, and just going to repeat everything. So I don't want to do repeat everything because that would just be a pointless exercise, and it would just... It's been after lunch and it's tiring and things like that, so you don't want me to repeat everything. But I will do is ask one question and make two comments, and we'll see how that goes. The question that I want to ask is not going to be necessarily answered by my talk, but I think it informs what I want to say. And the question is this: how and when did Europe become European? So that's the question I want to ask. And I guess if I was to ask everyone in this audience, what is Europe? I may be wrong, but most people would start off by giving me a geographical definition of some sort. Or some of you may say that Europe is a European Union forever and ever and things like that. Coming from Brexit Ireland, of course, that's not the case. But the question about Europe, I think, and Europeanness is really, really central to all we want to say. So that's the question I want you to think about. When does Europe become European, and what are the processes involved in that? Now, an American pragmatist, Charles Peirce, once wrote that the value of a concept is a function of the difference it makes to our practice. And I think that's really, really worth holding on to. A lot of us are in the academic business, and we think inventing concepts is a great way of furthering your career and doing things and writing papers and complaining about someone else who wrote a paper, etc. So you get involved in this kind of almost fetishism of little things. But the real value of a concept is what the worker can do. So I want to really talk about the work that the concept of Islamophobia can do, the work that Islamophobia does in changing our practices. That's what I think is really important. Now, I'm helped in this because many of the panelists have talked about how Islamophobia has been useful in identifying certain forms of violence, certain forms of cruelty, certain forms of discrimination. And how it ties into many other forms of cruelty and violence, etc. So I think what I want to say here then is that perhaps what we need to think about Islamophobia is not something which is really about the protection of a minority or a so-called minority. But really, Islamophobia is about the projection of a different kind of whiteness. And what I'm trying to say here is that maybe we should think about Islamophobia as the inscription on the body of Muslims, the crisis of Europeanness or whiteness. Now, why I'm saying this is, well, I'll tell you why I'm saying this, but I want to explain what I mean by that. When did Muslims appear in Europe? Again, if you ask this question, it looks like an empirical question, and someone can say, well, it was the 7th century with the Battle of Poitiers, or it was with the conquest of the Iberian Peninsula, etc. You can make up those things, but that's not really what the issue is. When did Muslims appear in Europe, I would say to you, is actually quite recent. And you can date it. For example, in Britain, there were no Muslims before 1989. And what I mean by that is, of course, there were people, there were mosques, there were halal butcher shops, there were people who went to worship, but there were no Muslims. Similarly, in most parts of Europe in the early 90s, before the early 90s, there weren't Muslims. There were Kurds, there were Turks, there were Maghrebis, there were Senegalese. There were people from many, many different ethnic minorities. And they were counted and considered to be people from different minorities. There were no Muslims. At some point, something happened. Muslims appeared. And partly, of course, is that you could say it's a reclassification. These people who were considered to be Kurds, Turks, South Asians, Maghrebis, Senegalese, suddenly became redescribed as Muslims. And in that redescription, many, many things were possible. So one of the issues became that often the xenophobic right-wing parties of Europe, and notice I'm still talking about Europe, had expressed their hostility to immigration and ethnic minorities in national terms. There were specific kinds of tropes. At some point, the far right rediscovered its pan-Europeanness. And one of the things I could argue is this, that with the integration of the European Union, there was a crisis of national identity and nation states in many, many parts of Europe. And in one way, Muslim women wearing the headscarf became the symptom of expressing that crisis. What did it mean to be a national government when really many of the things that you associated the national government with were being pulled together in the European Union? It was a whole new project. And the construction of a pan-Europeanness also meant that having a pan-European exterior, a pan-European other, made it much more easier to articulate what Europeanness meant. If you look at the debates around the role of Christianity in the so-called European Constitution, if you look about the various struggles for Turkey to be allowed in to Europe, one of the odd things about Turkey's prolonged talks to join the European Union is there are countries that did not exist when Turkey first applied have become members of the European Union, and Turkey still hasn't been able to do that. Why is that? What are the rationales for it? Now, we can all look for different kinds of rationales, but there's a certain kind of logic here, and it goes back to the idea of, for example, how European do you have to be part of the European Union? And what is the matrix of identifying something as being European? Now, if I was a provocative kind of person, which I'm not, I would say to you, which is more European? Istanbul or Berlin? Now, the answer seems so straightforwardly easy that it's not even worth asking, but let me try and explain to you. If the root of Europeanness, which is narrated in most European textbooks and most European narratives of themselves, where you have the beginning as kind of from, you know, you go from Plato to NATO, and that's the story of Europe. So along the way, the Roman Empire occupies a big part of that story. Yeah? Now, we know that it's the clues in the title. The capital of the Roman Empire was Rome. Okay, so we got that part. But the second capital, which was in many ways one of the older capital, was Constantinople. The first time when the Ottomans are described, what we call the Ottomans in diplomatic records, they're called Romans. The Venetians don't talk about them as Turks or Moors or Muslims or Hajarines or Ashlamites or Saracens. They say Romans. Now, if you start doing that, then the whole question about what makes Europe European, I hope you can see there's a link, that it becomes slightly more interesting or slightly more complicated. So, what does this have to do with Islamophobia? Well, the short answer is everything. Because if Islamophobia is no longer just about what happens to Muslims, Islamophobia, as I said to you, is about the inscription of the crisis of Europeanness on Muslim bodies. How that manifests itself is in the way that what does it mean to be European is now increasingly told by the idea of what the frontier of Europe must be, what excludes the figure of the Muslim. And as many panelists have said, it's not really the empirical Muslim. It's not the ethnographic or the demographic Muslim. It is the Muslim or Muslimness that represents a certain scandal. And it is that scandal which interrupts and interdicts the continuity of a particular version of Europeanness. Now, this scandal of Islam, or Muslimness, I suppose, has three main vectors, if you want to put it this way. The first one is a kind of a geopolitical scandal and challenge and difficulty. And we're all aware of that. And it ranges from having things like terrorists and rogue states and countries which may have nuclear weapons or may not have nuclear weapons, and all kinds of paraphernalia in which we can understand the war on terror. The war on terror now has become the grammar of international relations. It has established itself in lots of small protocols and institutions across the planet in which it regulates how people move, it regulates all kinds of things, and it is how we make sense of the world. So, for example, as we sit here in Berlin, there are probably 1,000 Uyghurs, or Uyghur Muslims, in re-education camps. I was going to say concentration camps, but no, they're in re-education camps. We have, a year ago, or ongoing genocide massacres in Burma. We have ongoing, one of the longest occupations in Kashmir in Palestine. All of these things, and what is interesting is if you go to China, if you go to Burma, if you go to India, if you go to Israel, you will see a common family resemblance of what is actually happening. And people have talked, not just on this panel, on previous panels, on common tropes, on tropes around which circulate in a particular way. So the idea of the Muslim as an immigrant, and the idea of the Muslim as a terrorist has become so consolidated so that you can actually read one of the other. You don't need to say, it's almost like a metaphorical displacement where you simply go one from the other. If I'm saying terrorist, I mean Muslim. If I'm saying immigrant, I mean Muslim. You can see, for example, in the case of Burma, which is very, very interesting, they refuse to allow for the fact that the Rohingya are actually indigenous to that to Burma. They're saying that they're all Bengali, they're Bengali immigrants. They don't belong there. So you already have a global institution of Islamophobia, which perplexes itself, which presents itself around a certain kind of crisis of whiteness. Now, why I talk about whiteness is I want to talk about it not as in relation to anything kind of ethnographic. This is the whole reason why I raise the question about what makes European Europe, but simply as a political crystallization of a particular form of governance and global governance. So Deepa, for example, very helpfully mentioned Magnus Hirschfeld's book on racism, which is probably one of the first accounts of the category of racism being used in 1938. And as she mentioned, look what it's written, and what it's trying to describe is the experience of Jews, mainly Jews, some Roma, in Germany. The question I would like to ask you is why did we need the concept of racism then in 1938? What was happening in 1938 in Germany was no different than what was happening in the British Empire, the French Empire, the United States. You can make a list as long as you like. You're talking about segregation, you're talking about forms of apartheid, you're talking about various ways in which racism was used as a means of regulating and governing. It wasn't just about attitudes, that you didn't like somebody or you didn't find them very appealing or you hated their food. It was actually about governing. And therefore, what you're talking when we say about whiteness is not particularly an idea which is simply ethnographic, but it's really a form of governing the world. It's a form of a world order. So if the first part of this, what I said to you, the challenge, is geopolitical, the second element of that is a cultural challenge. And again, the expression of that is so commonplace that I don't need to go to it. And the brunt of the cultural challenge is often met by women, and we've noted many times that how, especially women who are wearing the hijab, but just women in general, often are the focus of Islamophobia to an extraordinary extent, but also youth. And because behind both of these things is a certain kind of scandal. How is it that women can be Muslim? Because if Islam is misogynist, therefore, the only way a woman could be Muslim is because either she's repressed or she's insane. Yeah? And then the idea of the liberation of women becomes really, really central. Yeah? Similarly, the other thing is young people, youth. How can young people be Muslim? Again, this is where all the narratives about pathology comes into it. Because if young people are the future and Islam is in the past, the only reason they can do this is because they're undergoing some kind of psychosis. Because they should really be projecting this in the future. So that's the cultural aspect, and I don't want to dwell too much on it because everyone, you know, it's quite complex. The third thing I want to say to you, the third challenge that the figure of Muslimness produces in this kind of white world order is an epistemological or philosophical challenge. Or if you want it more prosaically, an academic challenge in a sense, how useful is the vocabulary that we have which has emerged with the birth of, let's say, the modern university? How useful is that vocabulary to understand and comprehend and to locate what the Muslimness is? Now, I could spend a long time doing that, and you'll be grateful to know that I'm not going to. I'll just concentrate on one category here, and the category that we use all the time, the category of religion. We seem to have a very clear idea of what religion is, but the only understanding that we have of religion is an Enlightenment understanding of a particular reading of particular forms of Christianity, which then are applied everywhere else. And lo and behold, everywhere else is not a proper religion. Now, this may be a slightly facetious point, but in the United States, for example, there are moves under the way to say that Islam is not a religion, and therefore is not subject to protection under the law, etc. But the whole category of what a religion is not something transhistorical. If you use your template for what a religion is, something like, let's say, Buddhism, you'd come to a very different conclusion. And what is interesting is before the use of the concept of religio to talk about religion, most Christianity, Judaism, Zarathustrianism, Hinduism, however problematic they are, use the words that we can translate into something like nomos, law, data, custom. If you think of religion as nomos or custom, or you have a very different idea of what it is and what it was. Now, what I mean by this is that is the category of religion, useful way of understanding Islam, and is it a useful way of understanding Muslims, and does it not really miss the point that when we're talking about Islamophobia, we're not talking about the same kinds of categories. Therefore, the defense that many people say is, look, I've got nothing against Muslims, but I want to be able to criticize religion, and Islamophobia stops me doing that. No, it doesn't. It just means don't use that vocabulary to do it. But the idea of religion having a specific place in the history of Europe doesn't mean it has to have the same place in the history of everywhere else. So the final point that I really want to make is to do with this. I got an email saying I should talk a bit more about living with Islamophobia. And so I'm going to in my final sentence. But what I'd like to suggest to you is living with Islamophobia, maybe living in the early days of a different kind of whiteness becomes possible. That is the true challenge of undoing Islamophobia. That to reimagine not just the present, but also to reimagine our future, but to do that, we need to be able to reconstruct the past that got us here as well. So really, if you want to do away with Islamophobia, you need to not simply deny it, but to destabilize the assumptions which are built into it. And Islamophobia ultimately is about the hollowing out of democratic spaces. It's about the forfeiture of civil rights. It is about actually transforming the relationship between peoples and states, as many of the panelists have mentioned. And therefore, to undo it requires us to think about the fact that once we identify a problem, it's only the first step. But it's a very important step. Identifying Islamophobia enables us to start working with that concept to undo what is the logic of Islamophobia, which is the crisis of whiteness. Thank you.
Thank you, Salman, for ending with a cliffhanger. I mean that is actually the most, I think, important question, just to analyze what's happening, but also reimagine what kind of alternative could we offer or how could we deconstruct our present and past, which leads me to my first question. James, you've talked about, in your talk about, you named a few participants in your studies who said they found it disempowering when there was too much, quote-unquote, talk about racism, anti-Muslim racism or Islamophobia. And you concluded saying that documenting anti-racism, anti-Muslim racism is not enough. Deepa, you talked about reasons why Islamophobia had arise in the past. You talked about why anti-Semitism was on the rise, what kind of mechanisms lie behind these kind of developments in our societies, and that Islamophobia today in our current times is an important tool for the war on terror, but also for capitalism to keep it going. And so keeping all of these things in mind, are we currently maybe just distracted, as Toni Morrison puts it? You're probably all familiar with her quote. It's one of my favorites. She says, the very serious function of racism is distraction. It keeps you from doing your work. It keeps you explaining over and over again your reason for being. They say you have no kingdom, so you dredge that up. They say your head isn't shaped properly, so you have scientists working on the fact that it is. It keeps on, and she says, there's no ending to this. So are we maybe just distracted by talking about Islamophobia, and is maybe talking about Islamophobia counterproductive to counter Islamophobia? Whoever.
Yeah. Sorry, I'll just give a quick shot to get things going, but speaking with people in my research, what was something that's really become clear for me, and I think others as well, is that when we engage with racist discourses at the level of, we'll say, interpersonal hostility and discrimination, we have to be careful that we don't repeat what they're saying about the Muslim or the Jew or whatever it might be, or whatever community might be being targeted. It was interesting for me within the speaking with Muslim women in particular, how they felt that they don't want to be re-presented again as being vulnerable. But I think the point of having the counter-narratives, we get challenged when we speak about Islamophobia. We're getting challenged because we're calling out a particular form of racism. And I know within the academic community we'll have people who go back and forth about whether we call it anti-Muslim racism or Islamophobia. And that's fine as an academic debate, but I think we're agreed on the fact that people are impacted by this in their daily lives. And those the very quick snapshot I gave into the impacts this has on the immediate, on the proximal experience as a person. For example, Nasima was one of the young women who spoke about, you know, locking her car doors. We have to talk about why she's locking her car doors. And what was interesting for Nasima was she locked her car doors because she heard of someone in the Muslim communities who was targeted in the street. Mm. Now, she actually had experienced it later herself. She had her hijab pulled. Her mother was punched in the back in a supermarket. We need to engage. I think, you know, in some ways, when we point it up and when we have, when we start talking about Islamophobia and when people push us back down and say, you can't talk about that because, you know, there's Muslims are this, Muslims are that, and all these kind of things we spoke about, that shows us the need to talk about Islamophobia. That shows us that we're pointing up something that makes people uncomfortable, and we should do. And the people that's making uncomfortable are those who benefit from Islamophobia, and which has been pointed out by a number of talks. Today, the point about not documenting it anymore, or not just documenting it, there are arguments in how we collect data on anti-Muslim racism, and we do need to collect data on that, but we need to become, can I say the word militant when I'm talking about Muslims? Oh my God, my flight home has got a lot more difficult tonight, right? We need to become a little bit more militant, though, when we're calling out those who are states who are inactive in challenging the racism, states who are active in perpetuating the racism. And we also need to provide those people who are experiencing it with some sort of ways of engaging and dealing with this in a real term. So I think we have to talk about it, but that's my two cents.
So one of the things that the right in the US likes to bring up is there's no such thing as Islamophobia because Islam is not a race. True, Muslims are not a race, Islam is a religion. But by that token, Judaism is also a religion, doesn't mean that anti-Semitism is not a very real form of racism, and the same is true of Islamophobia or anti-Muslim racism. And I think, you know, I've spent the last 17 years since 9/11 actually talking about Islamophobia. I hope it has not been in vain. I've both been a scholar but also an activist, being part of social movements to actually push back against anti-Muslim racism, which is unfortunately in the US not just a problem when it comes to the right, but also sections of the liberal left, right? People who buy as common sense the idea that somehow Muslims are more violent than other people, right? Somebody had those surveys up in a previous presentation that somehow Islam is more violent than Christianity or other religions and what have you. And that's just taken for granted, or that Muslim women are more oppressed than any other group of women. And, you know, rather than understanding that misogyny and sexism are global problems. And I'm constantly having to bring up basic sort of arguments again and again and again, such as, you know, in the United States, every year, 1,500 women, roughly, are killed by intimate partners, and it's known as a crime of passion. If you look at Pakistan, 1,300 women are killed by family members. But in that case, it's coded as honor killings, right? Like as if religion is making people do it, as opposed to the United States, where it's a crime of passion, it's just an individual man's passion. So we'll blame religion in some cases and not in others, and we won't call it misogyny, which is what it is, regardless of where it's actually happening. So I think these sorts of arguments constantly need to be made, because I think the left is really, really tiny. I think people who actually, you know, understand these kinds of arguments should name Islamophobia, name where it comes from, and actually take these on with people, because it's a problem both on the left as well as on the right.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's, of course, it's important. Actually, it'd be very cruel to say after all these 2 days, we shouldn't be talking about Islamophobia. I mean, you've just wasted all your days listening about Islamophobia. So I think the first thing that we should be talking about Islamophobia, so you can all relax. It wasn't a waste of time. But I think it's really, but I think what James said, I think said is really important. There's a thing about the document and documenting it. And there are kind of two issues about it. One of the things, of course, that we've already seen examples is the switch from a sort of welfare state to a surveillance state, in which the document becomes really, really the criterion of a certain types of control that we could never imagine. So that's the first thing. You know, in Northern Ireland, for example, during the 70s and 80s, every Catholic man, boy, over 12, was in police records. And just across the border, you have the Stasi records. They were done before computers. Now imagine all of that. And what does that mean to notions of freedom, about agency, etc., etc.? So that's one issue about the document. But the other thing, and I think both touched upon it, if we keep on talking about Islamophobia in relation to experiences of violence, we miss the biggest violator of all, which is institutional. When, for example, Usma and Yasmin were talking about going through you know, various things about airports, going through airports, often when you get checked by airport, it will be a person who is Muslim. They don't particularly hate you. They're not even bigoted. They're just doing their job. So in a sense, that a lot of the challenge of Islamophobia isn't simply to do, we would like to think Islamophobia is the function of thugs. It's actually the function of bureaucrats and administrators. They are also committing Islamophobia. Because the war on terror isn't just a war against whatever, it's a war which is transforming the relationship between citizens or peoples and their governments. So I think that's the other reason we have to talk about Islamophobia and not allow it to become individualized, because Islamophobia is about expression of Muslimness, not specifically Muslims. That's the key point here. This is why, you know, protesters who may or may not be Muslim, who may be Jewish, who may be Christians, can get caught up in the panoply which has been established to deal with the problem.
Salman, you just mentioned the privatization of...
Well, Deepa mentioned it first, I think.
Yeah, no, I was going to lead over to him then. you mentioned it, James, in your talk. It was a crucial part talking about how this, how Islamophobia or anti-Muslim racism is sort of, you know, outsourced, and the solution, but also the responsibility now then, you know, lies with individuals. And you, Deepa, you talked about how it is that the responsibility should never lie just with those who are subjected to it, but it's a general responsibility. But moving on from, you know, my previous question and all of the things you have said, obviously we should talk about Islamophobia in terms of racism, but what you all touched upon was, you know, actually looking at the sources and then seeing maybe we should be talking about war and terror, and maybe we should be talking about capitalism. So maybe is the next, you know, topic, step forward, as we talk about, you know, counter strategies and empowerment against Islamophobia, is the next step now to say, okay, we've collected data, we've analyzed everything as good as we could, we will continue doing that. Is now the next step to say, let's look at who profits from Islamophobia, what kind of capitalist structure is behind that, this, you know, you talked about global Islamophobia, and then, you know, I was wondering what is the role of Muslim countries such as Saudi Arabia. So maybe we could touch upon this, just think about what do we need to add to our agenda when talking about Islamophobia.
Okay. Pretty big question in many ways, right? I won't make any jokes because they're normally bad. In terms of what we need to do, where do we start, really? Okay. In terms of the nation state, for example, if we look at the institutional elements and kind of notions of belonging in the Irish context, so right now our police force in Ireland and very many police forces across the globe have this uniform that's supposed to reflect neutrality, okay? So there is no hijab-wearing Muslim. There are no Sikh members of the police force. despite the fact that people have made claims in the Irish context to have an inclusive police force that represents Irish society. Irish society is quite diverse now, we're not all white leprechauns anymore. Despite the racial stereotype, and surprisingly I'm actually sober. I don't even drink, it's mad. But we need to engage with the state to start reimagining. I think, Salman, your point there about this kind of notion of whiteness and this kind of crucial time that we could be in. At a kind of a micro level, it's almost at the maybe a meso level, we do it at the level of the nation state and start getting the state to engage with diverse notions of what it means to be, for example, Irish or German or whatever it is in contemporary context, contemporary society. Just to give you a very quick example in terms of the sort of exclusions that can prevail as a result of institutionalized notions of what it means to be Irish. Up until September of 2019, up until next year, schools can discriminate in Irish, in the Irish context, on the basis of one's religion upon accessing education. Now, you would say, well, you know, that shouldn't be a problem. There are going to be a lot of different state schools, so you'll have a lot of choice. Okay. In the primary context, in primary school education, so from that junior level up to 12 years of age, over 90% of the schools are in Catholic patronage. So the patronage, it lies with the Catholic Church, over 50% of secondary schools. Now we see a problem, okay? So you can see very many kids, in my own research and other researches, have been denied access into a school because they have not fit with the majority notion of what it means to be Irish. We know this old kind of white Anglo-Saxon Protestant notion of what it means to be maybe American previously. In the Irish context, we refer to it as being white, heterosexual, Irish, a member of the settled community, and being Catholic. So for us to challenge the exclusions that people are experiencing on the basis of their Muslimness and other identity factors, we need to start engaging the state critically on how Irishness is constructed. And that's one way of engaging with it, but it's one start point.
I'll just say a few quick things, and that is, so Iman started off this conference by talking about Islamophobia as anti-Muslim racism, and I think that's a great starting point, because there's a way in which understanding Islamophobia as racism immediately moves us to a place where we see it not just as a set of ideas, but also as being structurally rooted. So then the question is, what are these structures and how do we go about analyzing these structures and reforming them in the short term, but doing away with them in the long term? And I think part of the labor of doing this is also looking at anti-Muslim racism, not in isolation, but in relation to other projects of racial formation. So some of the work that I'm currently doing looks at the Arab terrorist, which is not something that gets formed in the United States after 9/11, but in fact goes back to 1967, when COINTELPRO, which is the infamous spying program, actually, first of all, COINTELPRO is created to police the Communist Party and the left and so on. And then it's expanded to target the New Left, and then the Black Panthers, and MLK, Martin Luther King, and the Civil Rights Movement, and so on. But it gets expanded to actually cover the Arab Left after the 1967 war, when Arab students in particular are considered terrorists at that point. So I think this kind of comparative work, which is how various groups of people are constructed as threats simultaneously, I think also helps us deepen our understanding, because in the early 1970s, you see in the United States, not only the construction of the black male as a criminal, right, which is one of the responses to the civil rights and the black power movement, is these are dangerous people. They take part in civil disobedience. They have no respect for law and order. And Nixon is all about a law and order society and the construction of a carceral state. That's happening at the same time as the power of the national security state to target Muslims, Arabs first, and then Muslims, and then Iranians, and then South Asians is going on simultaneously. So I think it's useful if we want to build solidarities And I think it was Mustafa again who talked about the coalition in New York City between the folks fighting stop and frisk and the folks fighting against the surveillance program and so on. It's important to see how the state, how the racial state actually targets various threats and how we can actually come together around a politics of solidarity.
Just briefly, you said about Saudi Arabia. I have no qualms about saying Saudi Arabia is Islamophobic. I don't think there's any reason or anything to doubt that. I think it's quite possible for some of the best Islamophobes, forgive me for saying that, are also those who say they're Muslims. Islamophobia is about stopping stopping autonomy of Muslim agency. It's about stopping that. It's about stopping Muslims' ability to write their own history. And there are many ways of doing that, and there are many people located on that. And there are many, many Muslim countries, for example, and Muslim governments who are clearly Islamophobic. So I don't think that's particularly... Okay, I'm not going to get an invitation to MBS, but it's a party, but anyway, there you go.
Yeah, I was referring to the war, military spendings, and et cetera. But I think it's now time to open the floor to the audience. If there are any questions, well, there's one in the front. Shall we collect them, or?
It depends on the questions.
Right? Yeah, okay, we'll collect them. Michael, whispering with a microphone doesn't really work.
I might not be sounding too articulate because jet lag is really hitting me, so I'm trying to survive, but I'll try, I'll give it a try. This is a bit of a support to what Salman said about Islamophobia. I don't mean to, so it's far from it. I'm very appreciative of this effort and all the rest of it, these conferences and this issue to be talked about and so on and so forth, to be discussed and all sorts of issues laid on the table. But all along, I have been, doing this post-colonial work. I have always been suspicious of a certain gesture that I kept calling a liberal multiculturalist gesture, which is easily articulated to the discourse of the global capital as well. Not, forget global capital. So this invitation to perform the native, this invitation to perform the oppressed identity, has been historically, 90s, heydays of all sorts of identities flourishing and so on and so forth, and you see it articulated from Benetton to millions of conferences and events on race, gender, ethnicity, the Holy Trinity, race, gender, class, or whatever. So every place was loaded with all these issues of racism. It's welcome. We know that there is something called benevolent imperial gesture. So these spaces are given. I'm not saying that we shouldn't be talking about Islamophobia or racism against Muslim groups. But unless we accompany that discourse with another critique of the sovereignty, I keep calling it the sovereignty of the European, Western, white, whatever, however you would like to name it, unless it is accompanied with that kind of critique, a really deconstructive gesture, that's why I was agreeing with Salman, that it is a problem of European identity. It's not simply about loving Muslims more and having them in they look at the, before the conference started, I met a former student of mine who's living here, and he was saying like millions of publications on Muslim immigrants in Europe, Islamophobia, it's flourishing. You find support. So these are not terribly innocent things. Again, without undermining what we have been discussing here. So I think there is a very tricky, there's a danger there that this can be easily articulated to the existing institutional frameworks. Let the Muslims speak. Look, they're happy talking about the racism, and now they've done then their criticism, and they go, and things go as usual, right? So I think we need to, what is the expression? Hit the nail on the head. Without doing that, I think this can easily become another imperial benevolent gesture. That would be my fear. So that's why I would agree with Salman's point about the Islamophobia to a certain extent. Sorry.
There's another in the front.
Hi. Thanks to the panelists. My question goes to Professor Sayyid. You started saying that you want to contradict to the panelists, and I didn't really understand the contradiction. Is it really contradicting, or is it adding an important layer of perspective on the topic, which is that, as you have shown and many others said before, maybe Islamophobia doesn't tell us a story about Muslims, but about whiteness, about Europe. And this is actually nothing new. You said you asked the question, Muslims appeared recently, or you started with when did Europe become European and when did the Muslim appear? And maybe he is very present nowadays, but maybe he has always, the figure of the Muslim always been here, but just invisible. Maybe we had different code words for it. Because I wrote recently a piece on German colonial congresses in 1905, which was the second one. And there you find debates where missionaries and scholars and politicians debate on the danger of the Islamization of German colonies. So the figure of the Muslim back then in 1905 was very crucial in governing, as you said, governing German colonies, regardless of the fact if the Muslim is real or not. It's just the figure of himself or itself. So this reminds me again, I go back to Sayyid because I love him. He says in his book, and I quote, in Orientalism, the Orientalist is all present, while the Orient or the Oriental is absent, always absent. So what Orientalism tells us the story, like Islamophobia, tells us the story about whiteness, tells us the story about Europe. And again, Gil Anijar, who was mentioned before by Maida, also puts this in the way that the Jew, the Arab, as he says, is about Europe. Europe is its limit and its limitations. So my question is, when you say this is a different kind of whiteness, why is it different? What is different about this kind of whiteness compared to the whiteness we have seen, like, historically, also in 1905, also in the 16th, 17th century? Not meaning that everything is the same, but where is the contradiction, and what is different about this kind of whiteness, this kind of whiteness?
I'll get one more question and then you can answer. There is one in the back.
Thank you. That was a dramatic walk to get the microphone. So a question for the panel, but I suppose prompted by Professor Sayyid's argument about the emergence of Muslims and Islam at a particular time. I guess I'm wondering what is lost in the Muslim story, and particularly what is lost about Muslim agency to say that Muslims didn't really exist until 89 in France and probably roughly around the same time in the UK. I'm thinking about the ways in which first and second generation Muslims who came as migrants and may have been characterized by the state as migrants of a national origin, themselves mobilized as Muslims, mobilized to create places of worship, mobilized to get concessions from the state to accommodate things like halal food provision, and had a community identity of Muslims. It seems to me that in that move to say that Muslim doesn't exist until there are certain regimes of governmentality which characterize these communities of Muslims, that kind of story of Muslim agency is diminished, and I think that's a challenge for us to think about.
Okay, thank you. Do you want to start?
Okay. I think just one point of clarification. When I said I wanted to disagree with them, I think what I was trying to say, disagree with them, is I couldn't. So that maybe wasn't clear. So it wasn't because I do agree with many of the things you said. I think in relation to, and again, the question about what is different, my idea was this, the potential exists that if you want to undo Islamophobia, you need to have a different kind of whiteness. You need to have basically a decolonization of Europe, if you want to put it that way. And that's the real project. That is what needs to be done. And we need to imagine a Europe without, which is decolonized. So it's a continuation and radicalization of the process of decolonization. And what would that look like is something that Europeans themselves and those who consider themselves have to understand and come to terms with. And it's going to be complicated and it's going to be problematic. But there is that issue, the whole thing about whiteness as being locked into certain frameworks of authority and legitimacy, etc. Those need to be unraveled both at a local but more global or national level. Nasser, I think I think you're quite right in one respect, that there is the two different kinds of narratives going on here. And one of them is clearly the narrative about Islamophobia, which is to do with what's happening in Europe, etc. Yeah. And one of the important things about talking about Islam, Muslims in 89 with the Rushdie affair, etc., is to talk about how Muslims erupt into the public space, or with the headscarf affair, how they erupt into the public space. Now, what is also interesting at the back of this, which I haven't really talked about, is a much longer development within the Islamosphere, between the Islam, where since 1924, you've had various kinds of projects of reconfiguring what the relationship between the constituting a Muslim political subject. Now, that has always been kept two different kind of registers there. And you see these moments where people, you're right, they, when you think about it, why would you organize a mosque if you were not a Muslim? But how that Muslimness was expressed, for example, in most countries where there's, most of the Islamic world, where you have a dominance of Islam, you can look at the way that, for example, in the 1960s or the 1970s, how it's actually expressed. So you know the case, for example, in Tunisia in the 1960s, they banned fasting during Ramadan on the altar of economic logic. It's very hard to imagine, until very recently again, any other regime attempt in the Muslim saying, we will ban fasting. It's just very, very difficult. Or give even a more radical example. If you look at the career of Saddam Hussein, if you want to, if you look at him in the 70s, he is completely bought into a very kind of a Ba'athist, secularist, nationalist narrative. In the mid-90s, he puts Allah Akbar on the Iraqi flag, apparently in his own handwriting. But the point is that, okay, and everyone says, oh, this is a opportunistic gesture. The question isn't whether it's opportunistic or not, but why is that gesture seen to generate some kind of response or performance pushback that gives you something by doing it when it didn't do that in the mid-70s, etc., or he didn't think the need to do it in the late 70s, etc.? So there are, what I wouldn't want to say with this narrative is that there is only one thing about Muslims. I think what is happening right now, there are two different converging developments. There's a crisis of whiteness, which we've talked about in various ways, and linked to that in a much more complicated way is within the process of decolonization, I think is also moving towards an assertion of Muslim political subjectivity in very, very complicated ways all around the world. There is not one Muslim community where I don't think that's the case anymore. And if you look at the literature for 40 years, they've always been trying to isolate it. And if you look back enough, you will see the changes in that. So remember in the 80s, it was only the Iranians and the Shia who were doing this. Then it became only the Sunnis. Then it became, I mean, it's just closed constantly. And those are two world historical transformations going on at the same time.
I'll take a more historical approach to answering the question of when and why Muslims become visible in the West. And I've argued this before, and that is, and this is known to scholars who study this question, is that the relationship between the West and Islam, both these are constructions, is complex and contradictory, isn't it? That is, if Muslims are turned into enemies in the context of the Crusades, at the same time, in Muslim Spain, in Al-Andalus, there's a different attitude and a different relationship that Christians and Jews have towards the Muslim rulers of that society. I mean, this is the Islamic history of Europe, and it has very much to do with the advanced nature of technology and the society in the Iberian Peninsula, which cultivates different notions. And so at the same time as you have an enemy image, you also have deep respect for the people who are creating different knowledges, right, and the production of various kinds of knowledges at that time. And I think that's important, is to punctuate how there are these changing notions of Muslims and people from the East, which also happens. You know, Salman mentioned the Ottomans. There was a time before the decline of the Ottomans when the Ottomans were seen as the most superior European civilization, right? The best and the most advanced Europeans because of their kind of government and so on and so forth. The othering happens at a particular moment in time, and it's important to name that moment to know how these things, you know, happen and why they change and what the context is. And that's my argument in relation to the US as well, which is that in fact, if you look at the 20th century, and if you want to use the language of integration, Arabs in the US were one of the most quote-unquote integrated people. That is to say, they didn't have separate Arab-American organizations because they quite, you know, they blended into American society and so on. That changes after 67, right? And the question is why, and what's happening geopolitically that actually brings these, you know, particular changes to the lives of Arab-Americans at that point. So I tend to take a more conjunctural historical approach to understanding how Muslims are constructed and when and why and so forth. I just want to say a quick thing about multiculturalism, Mehta, if I may build on what you said. I've written about neoliberal multiculturalism, neoliberal feminism, and as of others, which is basically a politics of inclusion to make these projects, to make neoliberal capitalism much more palatable, isn't it? So particularly after, I mean, you know, people have written about how this is a long process starting in the 70s and so forth, but for the US, for the US military, after the collapse of the Soviet Union, there's a great attempt to recruit black people and members of the Latinx community into the army, the logic being that look at our military, it is so multicultural, and therefore we should be the police of the world because we represent the entire world in the people that are a part of our military. And of course, Colin Powell becomes the embodiment of this, and then later on there are spaces created through the politics of inclusion for women like Madeleine Albright, and then, you know, Hillary Clinton, Obama, and so on. And I think what all of these, you know, and what the politics of inclusion and identity politics as such does is it, of course, deflates from a critique of empire. Because, hey, as long as it's a black person, as long as it's a woman that's at the helm of empire, then it can't be quite so bad, right? And so it's a constant struggle to try to remind people that, yeah, Obama had much better language. He gave a great speech in Cairo and all the rest of it. But if you look at his actual policies, he expanded the drone program, not only in terms of the number of drone strikes, but the number of countries on which US drones were actually deployed and so forth, even including the killing of US citizens, right? Without due process through drone strikes and all the rest of it. So, you know, the limits of the politics of neoliberal multiculturalism and neoliberal feminism is precisely that. It's just a politics of inclusion as opposed to a systemic critique of the system itself. Absolutely.
Just to summarize it, she said that, you know, the more trickier question is what happens when we are included, and we are being included, but what do we talk about? Are we able to critique whatever is happening in the moment, or are we sort of, you know, used in that moment and instrumentalized? Yeah.
I think an interesting point is that we're not always included, which is another case in point where some discussions can be shut down, some. But yeah, I completely agree with you on your point in this kind of space of interculturalism. It's the point I made about badges and biryani, yeah? So we'll have this nice get-together, everything's great, because group hug and racism doesn't happen. No, I mean, absolutely. And again, the point around documenting racism, and in fact, I would argue in the Irish state, the fact that it now documents anti-Muslim racism was to, on a police database, very badly, okay, was to at least have on paper to show to the likes of the UN and other international bodies that, look, we do this, aren't we great at our interculturalism? So what spaces like this give us, if we kind of have to take advantage of this multiculturalism, neoliberal multiculturalism, is at least we can get a platform to say something. It's up to us then to take that critique further maybe and take action with it, okay? But we have to take advantage of these little gaps, these little chinks, and engage on their terms. Zachariah's point, I think, was really, really interesting because it threw up, I won't go to Nasser's point about agency, but this the point of whiteness, and whiteness in 1905 and whiteness today and the commonality, okay? So coming at this from an Irish perspective, Irishness historically has not always been white. And I haven't had to feel that until recently enough. I mean, I've experienced racism. I was called a terrorist, you know, when I just been an Irish guy somewhere randomly in the UK. Becoming Muslim makes it even different then, because now my Irishness is now, it's contingent again, okay? So can I really be Irish and Muslim, you know? My name isn't Arabic, but can I be Muslim? Can I be Irish at the same time? Is there not a mutual exclusivity? The similarity between 1905 whiteness and 2018 whiteness is the power dynamic, and how that whiteness can impact upon and can limit possibilities and opportunities for people who do not fit this ideal type of whiteness. Thank you.
All right, I would now close the... Oh, okay, cool. close the panel, and I think to summarize, there are, I think, more questions than answers, and I think that's good. I think one of the questions we have to think about is, what is whiteness at the moment? Maybe we could re-envision, we could ask a question like, how does a non-racist society look like? And maybe we should envision that and then offer an alternative. Thank you so much for the thought-provoking discussion. Thank you so much for listening.